Algonquin Books and Workman Audio present The Complicities, a novel by Stacey D’Erasmo, performed by Exy Sands. There, where you have landed, stripped as you are. From Dedications by Adrian Rich. After everything, Lydia framed one of her heart pictures and gave it to me. It's a heart shape made by a fallen plastic bread peg on the street. You can see the one along one fold. It looks like it's been run over a few times. The letters are worn. Sylvia gave me the bedspread she had knitted for Alan. The greens in it are subtle and varied, like the greens in a field. And it's soft. Gifts are so complicated, aren't they? Cultures use them as peace offerings, instructions, reproaches, bonds, displays of power. The Roma only give flowers in odd numbers. Even-numbered bunches of flowers are for funerals. What's that about? I hung up Lydia's picture. I put Sylvia's bedspread on my bed under the skylight. So I see them every day. Part 1. The Whale's Breath. Even now, I walk around with this feeling all the time. I want to say, you don't know how it was. I want to lay it all out so the whole shape of it is clear. It's so much bigger and stranger than you'd think. It wasn't what you'd imagine. Not for any of us. Not even for him. We were like the blind man and the elephant, so I guess you could say this is me drawing the elephant, or the whale, as it turned out. Because, and this is another part of my point, this is what's so frustrating about how stories like ours get told. There was so much that we didn't know because we didn't know one another yet. So much that I didn't know. And the things I knew couldn't help me when there were all these other things that I didn't know were happening. Besides, facts only take you so far. And even facts look different next to other facts. For example, how big was his crime? Bigger than a bread box, smaller than Chernobyl. If, let us say, the roof of your local high school gym collapsed during school hours because of shoddy construction, it was that big. So maybe it would be only a day in the national news. Unless it was your child who was in gym class when the roof fell in. And then it's the rest of your life and the lives of everyone you know. It depends on where you're standing. Of course, I happened to be standing very close because I was Alan's wife. Noah was just a teenager. In our case, the crime had to do with money. Alan worked in money, but it could have been worse. There are so many ways to go wrong. Terrible ways. I'm not saying he didn't commit a crime. He did things with people's money that you aren't really supposed to do. He'd been doing it for a long time, and he got caught. I thought he was clever about currencies and exchange rates, but it turned out he'd been doing other things. Anyway, people who were already rich got angry. But the damage, to switch metaphors, is like water damage. It isn't proportional to the crime. It seeps and spreads unpredictably. At first, people don't understand why there's a water stain, as it were, on the ceiling, or where the dripping is coming from. And then they do. And then it gets very bad. Life gets impossible, pretty much, and people have lots of opinions, and they say you destroyed their family's future, but did anyone care about our family and what was happening to us? Why were we suddenly the bad guys? Although the trial and everything after took a long time, it felt as if in one day my entire life vanished. Alan went to prison, I left him, left what was left of our Boston life, which wasn't much, and came out here to Chesham, Massachusetts, a lower to middle class beach town indistinguishable from the many such beach towns that line the curved upper arm of the Cape. Chesham is on the ocean side, a freckle not far from the Cape's elbow. By then, Noah was in a so-so college in Kansas and refusing to speak to me for leaving his father. My mother had vascular dementia and was living in a nursing home in Vermont. My father was dead. My two older sisters pitied me with all the silent vehemence with which they used to envy me. Our former friends dropped me. I was alone. I had no plan, just an instinct to get out of town for a while until I could figure out what to do next. I had a little money in my checking account from the divorce, my wits, two suitcases, and a car that I quickly realized would stand out too much in Chesham. I rented a house about a 10-minute walk from the small center of the small town. It was more a shed with electric baseboard heat than a house, a shingled shotgun shack with half-suns made out of painted strips of wood on the front. Darker inside than I would have liked. A low ceiling, a musty scent. A kind of upper half floor on which the bed, i.e. the futon, could lie with a plexiglass skylight above the bed. Tacked on at the back of the house shed shack, however, was a small addition with a double-paned clerestory window. It was unclear what this room, which opened off at the kitchen, could have been. Something to call an extra bedroom for summer rentals? But it was the small, secluded, semi-useless room that contained the house's one beauty that made me rent the place right away. Of all the ugly things I could afford, this one had that long eye set high above, and light slanting down from it. I sold the expensive car. With some of the money, I bought a little green used Honda that smelled of cigarette smoke inside and had only two working doors, both on the driver's side. The seats were covered in that fake velvety stuff, dull gray-brown with splotches. The smoke was baked into that fabric. Nothing would ever get it out. And anyway, somehow I believed that the smoke was what was holding the car together at all. The hubcaps were rusty, the gas cap was loose, and the windshield wiper in the back window didn't work. The car was cruddy, but it ran, and it provided great cover. So, there I was, alone, 49, still pretty enough, straight blonde hair and a straight nose, a slender build. I am physically stronger than I look, even freakishly strong in the arms and hands. My butt is bigger than you might think it would be when you see me from the front. In front, I'm ladyish, but behind, I'm a bit of a donkey. In Chesham, I could pass for any number of unremarkable women. Soccer mom, boutique owner, high school teacher, whoever. I used my maiden name, Suzanne Flaherty. Around here, that's the kind of name that's so familiar it almost doesn't seem like a name at all. Just a part of the landscape, like a hedge. That was how I wanted it, because people make a lot of assumptions about someone like me. I mean, look, sure, you can call me complicit, but there's complicit and complicit, isn't there? It isn't only one thing, one label that explains everything in every situation. There isn't complicity, but complicities, errors of different sizes. Plus, there are other factors, choices that in hindsight maybe weren't right, but in the moment it seemed different. Other people have done a lot worse things. Pol Pot, drug cartels, sex traffickers. And we weren't like those Wall Street buffoons you've seen, the nouveau riche ones you can see coming a mile away by the supernatural glow of their teeth veneers. I graduated summa cum laude from Smith. Alan was a complicated guy, and he truly was so smart. Incredibly smart. We sent Noah to Montessori school. We listened to NPR. Our friends were really interesting people, local artists and a chef and gay guys who went to Burning Man every summer. We composted before hardly anyone else was doing it. No one ever really believes that you didn't know, but there's knowing and there's knowing. I knew that a good life cost money. That's what I knew. And I knew how smart Alan was and how hard he worked. Let's put it that way. The upshot was that when I got to Chesham, I had no resume, even though I've worked hard all my life. My last job on paper had been as a publicist for a wine distributor, but that was way back when Alan and I were first going out, and those skills didn't mean much here anyway. This is a year-round town, not all summer rentals, and it traffics intangibles, things to eat, wear, use, smoke, or help you stop smoking. A little praying here and there, a rehab center in the next town over. Also commercial fishermen, Brazilian and Ecuadorian immigrants who staff the kitchens and hotels and the many motels, the Almeida butcher and a restaurant next door run by the butcher's son, a yoga studio next to a snip and wave beauty parlor, a few CBD emporiums. It was clear that I was going to have to improvise. I got the idea from that room with the clerestory window. It was so calming in there. It reminded me of a place I used to go to get massages all the time in Back Bay. My favorite masseur was a man named Eagle, who had to be 45 if he was a day, and always smelled of sage. Maybe that's why I rented the house subliminally. I was standing in that empty room, wondering what to do with it, and all at once, I remembered the scent of sage. I thought, and I have no idea how this could suddenly happen, but it did. It was a strange time in so many ways. Well, maybe I could do that. I could try, couldn't I? What did I have to lose? Who would know if I failed? I found a little online course, and it didn't take more than a weekend to do it, and then print out a certificate. I framed the certificate and hung it in the otherwise empty clerestory room. Eagle had something like that on the wall in the Back Bay place, hanging under the shelf with all the plants. I thought of it all as an experiment, something to do in between the life I had left and whatever I was going to do next, kind of like a hobby. It was easy to set up. In one weekend, I had decorated the room in early coven and picked up a space heater and a table that would do. With a twin-size futon on top and towels and blankets and sheets on top of that, it felt great. Just like the real thing. I nailed a face cradle to the table, hammering efficiently. I bought some oils like those Eagle had used and a few CDs of soothing instrumental music. I put up a flyer with those little tear-off tabs on the bulletin board at the small, quaintly shingled library in town.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.